Again, this time moderating a roundtable, which I think will be especially interesting for the Decidim public because they deal it deals with different digital aspects of deliberation. So we will have with us this morning Eloïse Gabadou from Open Source Politics. She will talk about the digital participatory process that fed into the French Climate Assembly, where they used two open software, Decidim and Iramutec. Then we will hear Mauricio Mejia from OECD. They have published a series of articles exploring the different uses of digital tools for deliberations, and he will share them or share the conclusions with us. And finally, Kelly McBride from Democratic Society. She will develop a topic that is especially relevant in countries like Great Britain and Spain, which is the scale of the assemblies. So each of them will have 10 minutes to do a first presentation, then we will have 30 minutes for debate. So you know that you can post comments on MetaDecidim. I will give them the floor right now, not to spend more time on presentations. Eloise, it's to you.
Hola. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I don't know if you can hear me well. I hope so. Okay, great. I'm so happy to be here, surrounded by the Decidim community that I've been working with for 2 years now. I'm just going to share a little presentation, so let me know if everything's all right with the presentation. Let's see. There you go. Mari, can you see it?
Yes.
Okay, great. So talking about an interesting topic today, so citizen assembly, on my end, I will be talking about the digital process that fed into the French Climate Citizen Assembly, so the digital process that Open Source Politics designed with for this project, designed on Decidim. For that, so I thought it was interesting to and important to understand the context in which the French Climate Assembly was actually born. It was a context of political unrest with the Yellow Vest movement and the national debate on the carbon tax. It was also the follow-up of the national grand debate in 2018, which was the kind of the first state-led national democratic exercise, which led to many frustrations due to the lack of transparency of the final results and reports. There was some debate on regarding the end results of that debate. There was also this year and last year the climate urgency and the important fact that there was a growing general awareness on the climate urgency and climate marches and younger generation in 2019 advocating for governments to respond to the climate urgency, and most importantly, and that's been for a couple of years now, the citizens' defiance towards the government, be it in France or internationally. And it was this climate of political unrest that kind of needed to be alleviated by a government response. All of that led to also Macron that had to politically communicate and had to demonstrate some responses in the face of this climate urgency, especially for someone who included climate. And that's an important thing to notice as well, because his position for the French Climate Assembly was kind of important. He was the main political sponsor, and that's something that kind of differentiates the French Climate Assembly from other countries where the president is not the main political sponsor. Here we really have a president that kind of sponsored directly the French Climate Assembly. So a couple elements that Arantxa also mentioned in her keynote, it was a French Climate Assembly that was supposed to answer to one question, which was how can France reduce greenhouse gas emission by at least 40%? From the 1990s levels by 2030 in the spirit of social justice. That's the question that basically was a political one as well. It's in the program of the France needed to answer to this question. And for that, they actually organized 150 they randomly selected 150 citizens according to six criteria, which were gender, age, level of diploma, the professional, socio-professional categories, the type of territory, so rural, urban, or the outskirts of cities, and the geographical zone. So they randomly selected those citizens, and to define a set of measures that will be submitted without filtering either to a referendum or to a vote in parliament or applied by regulation. So it was 5.4 million euros, which is, I think, four times the budget that the UK allocated to its climate convention. It was 9 months of work. It was seven sessions, six themes, and at the end, a report of 400 pages and 149 measures written by citizens, randomly selected ones. So basically, I'm not going to focus too much on the in-person process. You can look on the website. It was seven sessions over 9 months. The important thing to know and to take out of that was the fact that they took time to organize the deliberation, to provide information to the citizens so that they could, you know, make some actual measures, be also surrounded by economists, lawyers, to actually write measures that could be easily applied by the government without filter. So now to the topic of this discussion. Why did we and did the French Economic Council, the CESE, added a layer of digital participation to the in-person deliberation process? At the beginning, there weren't supposed to have any platform. There was only supposed to be the in-person deliberation process. It was kind of done really quickly. And the main goals for that platform was to amplify the process to include all French citizens in the process online. It also allowed NGOs to have a specific platform to publish reports and data. And it also, with the intermediary synthesis, we could contribute to the work of 150 citizens by synthesizing the contributions coming from citizens, other citizens, and from NGOs. There was, in terms of design, there was some interesting choices that were done, mainly to deactivate comments, to limit to one contribution per theme. There was also an NGO and group verification, and there was something important about the synthesis is that we had to consider all proposals, NGO, citizens, at the same level of importance. And that's something really important to, you know, not basically deactivating comments, make it, you focus more on the quality of the contributions you're going to be giving to the 150 citizens rather than the quantity of the proposals and comments and discussions. And that's what we have in participatory processes in general. We kind of limit ourselves to the number, like we define success by the number of contributions on a platform instead of the actual quality of those contributions at the end of the report. So in more concrete terms, the Decidim platform looked like that. So it was that was a homepage describing also the process right below. The Decidim platform took also the six main themes, so you can see them there. In each theme, you could, there was a proposal feature, two proposal features, one for citizens and one for NGOs. So that's that. And then the three main lessons or point to take out kind of is the one I already mentioned. So the focus on the quality of the contribution rather than their number. So there was something really important about that, that by limiting the number of contribution published by a platform user to one per theme, was kind of a bold choice, and it was also important that those contributions would contribute, would very much contribute to the success of the face-to-face work. Then the second thing I wanted to mention is that there was also a need to prioritize the in-person exercise rather than focus exclusively on digital participation. It's a fashion to do digital platforms for participation, and here the choice was basically the focus has to be on the in-person exercise and on the 150 citizens that are working directly for defining the measures. So sequencing was an important part of the process when designing it, because it combined some participatory element and representative deliberation in person. And that's why the digital tool was a means to an end and not an end itself. Last thing, and an important one for this community as well, it was important that the process would place transparency as the core normative principle of the digital process. Transparency both in the rules of the game, like why are we having a digital platform? What is the random selection method? What are the steps of the process? What are the expected outcomes? But also, and again, that's very important for us, the transparency of the tools that are used to define to both structure the debate online and to analyze the contributions. Because if you have a report that impacts the endpoint of a convention, then at least the software itself to be transparent and their code in open source. So the kind of opening remarks, and that's the last bit, is basically we're not the ones that are going to be judging the outcome of the French Climate Assembly. We're going to focus way more on the how it was designed and the choices behind it. But there are some interesting questions that we maybe need to discuss in the debate, which is there was an ambiguous political response from the ministries in Macron. They were designing some half measures to alleviate the tensions. At first, he chose 146 out of 149 measures. Now it's becoming less and less. And he kind of, I'll talk more about those measures after. But there's kind of a new balance of power citizen versus government that is needed. Now the 150 citizens are reuniting in one, are constituting as an NGO. There's a platform designed for them to follow up on the government's actions. So they're kind of reinforcing that balance of power. And there was also a petition that was launched last week to guarantee the results of that convention. And the last question, which is, I think, important for us, is the French Climate Citizen Assembly remains an important example of nationwide deliberation exercises, but could it be replicated and well replicated locally? And what conditions and prerequisites would we need and are necessary for a successful local citizen assembly? I hope I didn't go beyond the time. This is...
just 1 minute.
Okay, great.
It was brilliant. Thank you, Eloise. It was so clear. And no, yeah, I think you really raised the right questions. They're telling me from the staff that you should reactivate your camera, because I think when you share the screen, the camera disappears, something like that. Okay. Okay. So yeah. Thank you. Thank you so much. So many interesting things and so many learnings from this process in France. So now we will hear Mauricio Mejia in English, which is a shame. I think you're Mexican.
I am.
But please.
Yes. Buenos días a todos y good morning, everyone. So my name, as Arantxa well said, my name is Mauricio Mejia, and I work at the OECD at the Innovative Citizen Participation area of work. And I'm just trying to verify that you can see my screen and you can see myself. And I think that's good. So let's go. So today I'm going to talk to you about the work we've been doing on understanding how digital for deliberation can work. And it's been working since April when we started. So very briefly, as you might know, and also because Arantxa very well explained during her keynote, we based on the first report of this workstream, which focuses on exploring how democracy is changing, where the future of democracy is going, trying to understand how new processes of citizen participation can be applied. And our first report was the report on Catching the Deliberative Wave, Innovative Citizen Participation, and New Democratic Institutions, which focuses on what Arantxa presented, representative deliberative processes, which in a nutshell means a randomly selected group of people that are representative of a community and that they spend some time learning, collaborating through deliberation to form collective recommendations to policymakers, like, for example, what Eloise presented, the French Citizen Assembly. So this report covers a lot of topics about deliberative processes, but we acknowledge that we needed to further research the discussion on the use of digital tools. And in April, when COVID-19 happened and we were all confined, we realized that it was the perfect moment to talk about this, not just because it was happening, but also because we felt that this was going to be a new normal in the way that if we are working and we are today completely online, we needed also to understand and focus on how to move from an in-person deliberative process to a digital deliberative process. So we launched a series of articles at the OECD Participo Medium blog with different perspectives from different practitioners, policymakers, to try to first understand how this transition was happening, how to go from the in-person to digital, but also trying to bring some evidence to give some recommendations and guidelines to policymakers and practitioners on how to do this transition and make sure that deliberation remains the key of the processes. So just very quickly, I'm going to go through a little bit of the conclusions, first initial conclusions that we get from this series of articles. And the first one is that deliberative has to come before digital. This means that the focus has always to be put in the process, in the design of the process, that it has to respect the principles of deliberation, it has to respect the stages of deliberation, and then we can think about digital, but not the other way around. And Eloise said it very well, digital is a means to an end, it's not the end itself. The second conclusion or point that I want to share with you today is that there is not a one model fits all for digital. This means that it's important to consider the different perspectives, scenarios, and purposes. So first think about when and how are we going to implement digital, then think about how to implement digital and then choose the tool, and not vice versa. Because we see different scenarios and we collected evidence from different scenarios to use digital, where it can be replacing an ongoing process like the French citizen assembly. It can be creating one from scratch, like the different COVID-19 related public discussions. It can be adding some elements of digital in one process like Eloise presented. But also the purpose can be different purposes. It can be just as a support function, for example, to do the sortition process, to vote, to allow citizens to collaborate and write in collaborative documents. It can be for one specific stage. So for example, all the learning stage can be done through online tools. It can be to bridge the participants from inside to outside participants. And finally, it can support the transparency and accountability of the process. The third point is, this is a very, I think, interesting point for the community of Decidim, is that technical choices have democratic implications. And what we mean with this is that the choices that we'll make in terms of the tools, in terms of the digital infrastructure that is going to be embedded in the process, will have implications on how the process works, on how people can deliberate, can interact between each other, because it depends how we design the tools, depends how we allow people to express through text, video, sound. It depends if we allow some asynchronous or synchronous interaction, if people are anonymous or non-anonymous, if there's moderation. And for example, today, the current design of the digital tools that we have to express ourselves, to exchange, to interact, are not 100% built for deliberation. We see a lot of polarization in social media. And so it's very important that the technical choices reflect the deliberative principles of the process. And a second point is that we know that technology is not neutral. And so it has to be transparent and explained, because this is important for the trust in the process itself. If algorithms are used for sortition, it has to be transparent and explained. If there is an AI or other type of tools to process the proposals or to moderate, it has to be explained, because this brings trust and security to the process as the process itself, the methodology that is using an in-person process. And a last point on this is not create path dependency. This means that by not pushing for one solution, we need to avoid creating this dependency on that solution, not to name one in particular. A fourth point is that evidently digital has benefits. And for example, we see that today we cannot physically gather. So in this case, digital is a benefit because we can run processes through digital tools. It can also allow for things that maybe in-person processes cannot, like international or cross-regional processes, a very large scale, ongoing and simultaneous, maybe with automatic translation, like it happened with the European citizen dialogues, or it can allow participants to better monitor, to have more transparency in the process. And finally, by using digital tools, it can also support the research and the evaluation, because we can have more recordings, more data, we can stream the meetings, we can create pollings, we can transcript the discussions, and this can allow for an in-depth research on the process. But with challenges, they come, with benefits come challenges. And so obviously there is challenges to the use of digital tools. And I think the first one is that we require skills and an onboarding that might not be the same for the in-person processes, because not everyone has the same skills, the same access, the same knowledge, the same approach to technology. So this has to be reflected on the choices and on the process itself. And as I said, technology is not neutral. So a challenge is that the tools that we use, they need to be compatible with our democratic values at the end. And they have to be also being one of the challenges that they need to create trust, empathy, social bond, which is very important for deliberative processes. And maybe digital, if it's not used correctly, or if it's not followed by some other tools or methodologies, it might be complicated to create this important trust and empathy between participants. And finally, digital needs human. This means that we still need mediators, we still need communities of practice, we still need to bring this humanity to the process, and not forget that even if we are through screens, humanity is very important. Empathy and communication are very important. So I wanted to just quickly, to don't go over time, go through a little bit of kind of a conclusion or maybe some points to further the discussion. First is that we've seen that digital deliberation can work. It has worked. We've seen a lot of processes being organized from scratch in a digital method in Mexico, in Colombia, as Arantxa said, but also in the UK, in other countries, in Taiwan, for example. So it can work. Another point is that it doesn't equal face-to-face. So we need to take it as a whole, not trying to compare or to replicate exactly how it works face-to-face. Third, as I said, human is very important. And fourth, digital doesn't mean cheaper or easier. We need to take it seriously and implement and put the resources needed for the process to happen normally. And finally, and this is, a food for thought for the community of Decidim, is that we need adapted digital infrastructure. We need to build tools that allow for deliberation, that are built for deliberation, and not use tools that are not built for deliberation and try to patch it and put it in a deliberative process. I think we need to think in this new normal, because I don't think that we will stop using digital for deliberation. And so I think we need a collective discussion on how to push and how to scale and how to explore new ways, continue innovation, continue experimentation, and create more communities to have digital deliberation in the new normal. So I just put here the names of the people that participated in our series of articles. I can share the links of the articles and keep posted, because we will continue publishing articles and conclusions, because this is, as I said, an ongoing work, because we need more experimentation, more evidence, and more observation. So thank you very much, and a pleasure to be here with you and to hear your questions.
Thank you, Mauricio. Your presentation was amazing. Like going directly to conclusion, which is good, because we have all the learnings in 10 minutes. It's fantastic. I would like to ask you from where you're talking. So Eloise, maybe you're in Paris?
Exactly, I'm in Paris.
Okay. Mauricio?
I'm in Mexico.
Mexico, so wow.
A little bit early, but
sorry about that.
Committed to the cause.
Okay, great, thank you. And Kelly, you're talking from?
Hi, I'm in Edinburgh, Scotland, myself.
Oh, you're in Edinburgh, fantastic.
I am indeed, great. And I'm joined by my wonderful colleague today as well, Mel.
Mel, sorry, okay.
We're gonna double
it a bit. Yeah, I was seeing both faces, and I was not sure who was who. Okay, this is good. Okay, great. And Mel, you're in?
I'm in Brighton, on the south coast of England.
Oh, yeah, we know it, of course, Brighton. Oh, great. Fantastic. So I give you the word. So please tell us about this scale thing.
Yes. So we're going to take a bit more, I think, of a casual approach today. And myself and Mel are just going to share a few insights, I think, from the work that we've been doing and a few reflections. So I think between us, we've got quite a bit of experience now of working on citizens' assemblies at the local level, at the national level, and exploring them on a pan-European level. So this idea of networked European democracy is something that DEMSOC is working on. So I'll tell you a little bit about DEMSOC first, for those of you that may not have come across us. So the Democratic Society is an international nonprofit organisation that's been going for just over 10 years now. And in the last few years, we have started projects all across Europe, although we're an organisation that started in the UK. So we've been working in over 24 countries, over 150 projects, looking at the different ways that people are involved in making and shaping decisions that affect their lives. So we think quite deeply about the connections between people and power, but we also very practically design and facilitate spaces for people to come together to shape decision making and be involved in discussion and learning about power and how decisions are made. So that led us to doing some work over the past couple of years around citizens' assemblies. So that's thinking about the models for citizens' assemblies, but also very practically designing and delivering them at different scales as well, working with a range of different partners. So myself and Mel are both very involved in the design and facilitation of assemblies. So we consider ourselves to be practitioners, I think it's fair to say, Mel, as well as people that are obviously really interested in the interconnection between assembly processes, social movements, and the different sites in which people are kind of learning about decisions and supporting them to be made. So what we're going to do today, and as I said, it's going to be quite casual, I've got my cup of tea, is just share some of those reflections and particularly around the key aspects for the design of assemblies and the ways that they are kind of framed and thought about at different levels. So I think that the presentation that came before was a perfect setup, really. Because we have been able, I would say, to successfully deliver citizens' assemblies from kind of small microgroup scale. So, you know, we've had small groups of people come together to well over 120 people coming together for a deliberative process. And I can't see any reason why that couldn't be larger and more interconnected between different places. There's no reason I can't see that being possible from the experiences that we've had. And we've had people taking part. I mean, there's a process where there's someone that's literally never been online before, and this is their first ever interaction online. So I'm sure we're both going to touch a little bit on the supporting environments had to be built around to enable that to happen. But I want to start from a place of kind of possibility and hope to say that we think it can be done. We think that it can be scaled up. But there are, of course, challenges that come along the way. And a lot of things that I think we still need to work through as a kind of practitioner and research community. But I'm going to hand over to Mel in just a second, who's going to start talking a little bit about some of the local trends for citizens' assemblies and some of the experience she's had in delivery and of the various processes we've been involved in. So, Mel, are you ready?
Okay, sure. Obviously, I'm talking from a UK perspective specifically for this talk. But just to give you an idea, a sense of how we talk about the deliberative way, but in the UK at a local level, my gosh. So I had not done citizens' assemblies as a method much at all before 2019. Last year, I designed, run, delivered four local citizens' assemblies currently doing a completely virtual online one at the moment. I think the thing that makes the scale question really interesting and then overlay digital on top of that is the context and the question. And we all know, like, you know, you've got to really be really clear about why you're doing a citizens assembly, what the purpose is. And I think there's some things that work really well at a local level and some things that don't. You know, some things you think, hang on a minute, because part of the issues around us sort of working at a municipality level is the sphere of influence that those local decision makers have. You also have multiple players and decision makers in a local place. So, for example, one that we did end of last year, beginning of this year, was a council in London on tackling hate crime. And I'll use it as a case study, because what was really interesting was that it was the local authority, the council, commissioned it and supported and paid for it. but quite clearly hate and hate crime and incidents is linked to policing, is linked to mental health, is linked to health services, is linked to the voluntary sector. So you end up with this leadership model where, depending on how connected the governance and decision makers are, impacts on the quality and the impact of the recommendations and essentially making them come to life. What it also enables, though, at a local level, is you start seeing participants actually shift from doing the deed and handing over to owning the recommendations themselves. There's an ability there for them to be co-producers of the solutions, to work in partnership at a local level with the commissioner and with other decision makers, and to be involved in the rollout and the doing of the things because they're in their local places and they can connect and interact with them. I think it's different at a national level and at a European level. And I think that's the point that I'll hand over to Kelly to talk about how that then impacts there.
Yes, certainly. So I think when you start then moving from the local to the national, and I'll get onto the European scale, although this, what I'm about to say is relevant there too, that question about who is commissioning a process and who recommendations are for and where things are going to be implemented, becomes a bit more of, I think, a contentious discussion in some ways, and a bit of a discussion that's scrutinised in a slightly different way to how you see at the local level. And of course, some of the discussions may be limited by the kind of competencies of commissioning organisations. Of course, you get that at the local level too. And it's interesting to sometimes see local processes where people want to talk about bigger things and feel, I guess, a little bit limited by the power, but then they come to talk on how that can be addressed in different ways. And then, you know, people become really interested in that connection to power. And it's something that we've noticed recently is an evolving discussion where I don't think anyone really knows the answer to this, and it's being talked through, is then the connection, because so many assemblies are commissioned by governments and other organisations of that ilk, how it connects with social movements who are pushing for more socialist, for more citizens' assemblies, and for more involvement in the governance of different processes. Mm. And we're seeing that, of course, play out now, particularly around climate assemblies. I know that we saw it in France, we're seeing it in the UK, we're seeing it in Scotland right now. But I think that question of citizens' assemblies and the connection with social movements and wider civil society movements is certainly something that we're going to be grappling with a lot more deeply over the next wee while. And that has huge implications as well for, I think, the question of scale. I know that there are some in civil society who think that actually we need to organise assemblies at scale, but they need to be not commissioned or connected necessarily to those sites of power to begin with. They need to be starting from the community level, community led, and we need to get them together as an organised civil society. So I think that's a really interesting thing for us to think about. And then, of course, we know the power of that organising at the local level and the ways that you can bring people together. And what we still need to explore, I think, as practitioners and to do more around, although we're seeing a few examples spring up in the European space at the moment, is how you have those conversations at the local level, that place where people feel a bit more connected, where it may be easier to organise in some ways than others. But you take all that good stuff that comes out and you connect it to conversations happening in other local places. You then connect that to national policy conversations. And in Europe, you then connect that to the conversations that are happening at the European level. We haven't got a load of examples about how that works in practice at the moment. And it relies on those different levels of governance coming together and agreeing essentially about how information should flow, how it should be synthesized. And there's a real challenge in getting so many different actors, I think, working together to have a connected process like that. So that's where when I mentioned the idea of networked European democracy, which I may mention again later, that's what I mean, that connection between the local, the national, the European level, and how you bring all those conversations together. And I know that synthesis of inputs from processes like that, as well as the synthesis, so the bringing together and the analysis and the presentation of the data that comes through some of the bigger consultations, perhaps digital consultations that then feed into assembly processes, it's just such a huge ongoing challenge, no matter what level we're working at. And I know some places are starting to kind of use AI to deal with that, but then a lot of people think that's completely inadequate. And actually, you need to maintain that human element and deal with the subjectivity that could come through. And I think that's really interesting. Mel, did you want to?
Yeah, I'm just going to pick up a little bit on that, because I think digital has really opened up the opportunity for that sharing, connecting in ways that I hadn't always anticipated before doing digital, which is particularly around the source of learning and evidence and experts. So as an example, and I think climate is one of those in particular that we could focus on as a connector across that. So in Ada and Worthing, local authority who are doing climate assembly at the moment, they have had 45 experts make videos, take part from across the world, who are really willing to share because it's digital. Because you can join from Mexico, it's easy. It means that we can make sure there's an inclusivity of our speakers, that, in terms of ethnicity and gender and lived experience, where the topic is more systemized, that you can learn about how what you do in local Brighton is connected to what's happening in India. And we have, we've got 45 videos of experts from across the world talking from climate justice to food production to waste. That's an amazing resource. And it's sitting on the little Ada and Worthing website. And I just think there is potential here for something bigger and greater around deliberation and the deliberative process that we could maximize on this, change to a more digital way that we could build on and connect with across the scales.
Great. Yeah. Do you want to add something or no?
I was just going to say what Mel just said there. Yeah, materials are replicated. Yeah,
it's 13 minutes, but yeah. Okay. Okay. Thank you. Thank you so much for sharing your thoughts. Yes, of course, digital is more inclusive in terms of participants. It's more inclusive also in terms of experts participating. As you said, a lot of experts from all over the world can come to these citizen assemblies and share their knowledge. That is really great. So we don't have so much time, of course. It's always the same. We just have 20 minutes. I would like this to be a dialogue, so please just intervene anytime. Maybe I would like to ask one question to all of you to start this conversation. I will do the three questions, let's say, at the same time. So, Eloise, I had a very practical question, because I think the public that is also hearing us is our practitioners that are already using digital platform, etc. So it was about the budget that was needed. Maybe I don't know if you have the data for this, the French Citizen Assembly, for this specific side of the digital platform. And if we don't have the budget, how many people more or less were involved and during how many time in running this platform? Then I had a question from maybe Mauricio. My question for Mauricio is lost, but because you have been investigating or researching so many different digital tools. Yes, and as you said, there is not one model that would be that would fit all the context where it's needed, but if you could maybe underline one or two specific examples that you think really went well and that could be that the Decidim community could look from no Samira más de cerca. and then Mel and Kelly, I think you said a lot of things maybe you just mentioned very quickly, Mel, this idea of citizen assemblies starting also from the community. I know it was just a mention, but I think it's also an interesting idea. And I had the question in my previous talk, and I didn't really have a lot of elements to come to respond. So maybe you can help us. And also I had this question in the previous talk about when there is, as you said, Kelly, that at local level there is this clear shift, which I think already also happens at other levels, but from someone who is not really interested in the thematic, and then who would become co-owner of the process. So do you have like examples in your head of when it happens? Because I had the question before, like clear moments where this shift happens during the processes. So if you want to start, Eloise.
Yeah, there was so many good questions. So it is, there are practical questions, and I wanted also to maybe answer to some points that were raised by the democratic society that I thought were interesting. First elements of responses. I'm not so sure about the budget. If I remember well, it was around 20,000 only for the platform, and that only is the cost of the platform. But related to the number of people inside of open source politics that were actually on the project, we were two to install the platform, to mm-hmm. like set up the platform, the spaces, etc. Mm-hmm. We were three to do the reports. Mm-hmm. And I think I'm just going to add an important part of what you said, guys, at Democratic Society. I think the importance of synthesis is like it's increasing so much because it's the only way to communicate the results of a, you know, deliberation process. And at OSP, we used Iramutech, which is which is basically an open source NLP process, data processing tool. And I think natural language processing, there needs to be more research, especially for us at Decidim and in the Decidim community, for NLP and how to best respect citizen voices with techniques that involve both human and AI processing. So, and I think again, and that maybe is redundant, but the algorithm behind NLP have to be transparent, have to be open source, have to be documented, communicated, and transparent for everyone. So that was for the number of people really on. And by the way, for the synthesis for the French Climate Assembly, we use both a mix of NLP and human analysis. So out of the number of contributions we had to treat equally all proposals. So we had to list them all, to rewrite them, to rewrite the title to make it coherent with all the other titles. We had to analyze the categories and the sub-themes that were arising and stuff like that. But what we did with NLP was creating some co-occurrence schemes to see how frequent some words were going together, were cited together. And that was maybe the most interesting part because, some sentences and some wording, some ideas were reoccurring together frequently. So imagine just like ideas of social justice and climate change going together all the time. That's some kind of, interpretation that we can have, which is very interesting. And then I don't remember the last question.
No, I think it was mainly about the team. And also if you have any data that the citizen, the participant in the convention actually read the report. I don't know if there are some surveys or.
So we don't have any, we didn't do any surveys. What we have are videos and pictures of citizens, just with showing the reports. That's basically the only data we have. But we don't know how much those synthesis, and I think that's an important part for future deliberation processes and digital ones, how much the synthesis are, read by citizens.
Okay, great. I was negotiating with the staff at the same time that we can have until 11:40 because we started okay. 10 minutes late.
Great.
So Mauricio, maybe.
Yeah. Well, I think we depends. Again, I come back to my point on the purpose of the digital. But if I just answer you very quickly on which process I would think it's interesting. I think, for example, the EU citizens dialogue that happened quite recently, end of October. It's very interesting because it's digital from scratch. It's 105 citizens randomly selected from 5 countries using automatic translation, and that actually it achieved some collective recommendation, and not only recommendation, but also through deliberation and through the process, they allow citizens to also get an idea of what is Europe and try to get some empathy about the European challenges and try to make them understand a little bit better what it means. And they got some the presence, I think, from Margaret Vestager. So I think it kind of exemplifies what could be a good digital from scratch process. I mean, obviously, I think VitaiOne, it's an example that needs to be quoted, but it has to be quoted already quite a lot of times. And then just focusing on specific aspects of other processes. I think, for example, the process in Bogota is interesting because it uses other types of tools, for example, WhatsApp, to be able to connect with citizens, have moderation through WhatsApp. So it's more using what citizens already use as a technology and putting the deliberation there. Another interesting, for example, also in Mexico, in Chihuahua, I think you mentioned in your keynote for the anti-corruption system, it was also just... It followed all the stages and all the necessary things to have a representative, sortition, stratification, deliberation, and so on. But it happened purely online, and if I'm not mistaken, on Facebook again, to allow for people that use already those tools, and also because it was a stream to other people. And then, for example, I don't know, thinking out of my mind, the Gov Lab created a data assembly, and they use Remesh, so another tool. Taiwan uses Polis to be able to have some consensus. So I think it's not that there is a magic tool, that's for sure, and that's maybe one point of it, but it's how and when we use it. And I think, I guess that at some point we will need to stop just thinking about Zoom as a tool for deliberative processes, and maybe think about maybe we need to create some specific tools for it. Maybe we need to mix and match different tools. So this is a little bit examples that I have in my mind, but I'm certain that there are a lot that I didn't quote. Evidently, the use of Decidim for the French Citizen Assembly, it's a notorious case study.
Great. Yeah, and we count on Decidim to build this magical tool that we will all need and that will fit to all the context and all the purposes and everything.
Or another open source community.
No. Today we are in Decidim. It has to be Decidim. Okay. So Kelly and Mel, maybe.
Shall I go first with the local stuff? So picking up your community question. I think that when Kelly introduced DemSoc and she talked about people and power, but the third part is actually place. So it's people, power, and places. And at the local level, you can really see the place element come hold. And what that means in terms of the community, but also in the decision makers, is that you can push them further on the question. So the question often is, what can we collectively do? What do we collectively think are the answers, as opposed to tell us what I, the commissioner, should do? And that phrasing is really quite important, and happens, the result is quite natural in the process, because you're coming from a local place. I'm speaking on behalf of participants, but they don't come in thinking we need to tell X, Y, and Z organization what to do. They come in thinking this is what we need to do for our place. So there's a sense of ownership and identity that's really powerful. And as they start creating the actions and recommendations, I have never seen one that doesn't have people want to be involved. There are always some citizens that start automatically getting involved in the recommendation, achievement of the recommendation, and the local authorities often create the space for that. So they're working with their citizens and the participants to actually do the doing. So that was my mention around the shift from, okay, you know, members to co-producing. And I think you get much more appetite that from commissioners of the assembly at a local level. They actually don't want a load of recommendations that they're like, oh my God, how do we afford it? It's not feasible. So feasibility and impact is part of that that's rooted in that local conversation.
Okay.
Yes, and you had a question around interest in the thematics. I'm not sure if I entirely understood it in the right way, but I'll say a couple of bits and let me know. So firstly, on the participant side, we don't start with the assumption that the people that are going to come know anything about subject matter, are really interested in the subject. We use sortition or random selection processes usually to get the group of participants that will take part. And the recruitment for that is done in a number of ways, depending on process. It could be sending out letter invitations. And of course, you'd expect a small skew maybe with people with some subject matter expertise. But often people we hear respond to that, even if they don't know about the subject, because they feel a sense of duty. Some of them, to be quite frank, are interested in the support and some of the payment and the learning journey that comes along with this. But when they're there in the room, they engage just like anyone else and take part and get stuck in. So I don't think we should look at that skeptically. Whereas in other processes, we go door knocking, and you can imagine you'd probably get to a different group of people using methods like that. Although, of course, in the world we're in just now, it's a bit difficult to do that. And we find that interest builds as people go through the process and they learn and they have that supported learning journey. So I think that there's lots of good stuff to say about that. And I think a lot of the research, the processes happening right now are being quite heavily researched. So soon we'll be able to see some really good comparative data, I think, around that. And I do suggest looking at the Scotland Citizens Assembly research that's being done. It's all online on the website, and the upcoming Climate Assembly research that's being done too. So I'm not sure that was the answer to the question you were looking for, but
I didn't understand well what you said before. No, it was this idea of, you know, 98% of citizen assemblies, citizen juries are of course implemented by governments. But there is also this idea, and it was the first Irish convention was implemented by a community. I mean, with the citizens. So I thought that at some point in your presentation, you mentioned this citizen assemblies being also able to be started by communities instead of government.
Got you.
But yeah.
Yeah. With climate, you can certainly see how that social movement and that swell and that public interest has grown and led to a point that has made a really strong case for doing citizens assemblies. But, you know, yeah, okay. Something lacking.
You want to say something, Mauricio?
I have a question on my end regarding, I was always wondering, and I think, Arantxa, you talked about that in your keynote, you know, the agenda of the citizen assembly, yeah. Who sets it and who discusses it. And the thing that I think made the CCC, the French Climate Assembly, also successful was the budget around it. And I'm wondering about, you know, if communities organize it, what kind of budget can be allowed and allocated to that kind of deliberation process? If we could have, you know, people from, you know, the non-metropolitan France, like if we had people around the world, just experts around the world, like also participating in that French Climate Assembly, was because of budget. So I'm wondering, you know, the structure we can allow when you're doing in person, now that we're doing digital, maybe that, you know, changes stuff. But yeah,
I completely agree with you. It was more in the case of countries or regions where nothing is happening, and that was the case in Ireland 10 years ago. And when you say if we don't do it from the community, this will never start.
Yeah, exactly.
So it's more, you know, like trying to start a movement than really pretending to do all the processes in that way. Then maybe a last question. Please.
I was just going to say it's an interesting quandary because part of the issue around climate in the UK is everyone's saying the answer is a citizens' assembly, and that's not always the answer. So, so crowdsourcing funding in communities, etc., because we want a citizens' assembly is not necessarily the right thing. It's about, we want action to these issues and we want to be involved and we want to have a voice, and that might be a different thing. So it's just making sure, I think there's a process before funding for citizens assemblies that we need to think about.
And actually, like the guard, like the safe guardian of the French Climate Assembly yesterday night, he was on a show on TV, and he was saying basically that the Citizen Assembly like is one way, but we need to complement it with many types of actions for climate, be it, you know, some nonviolent action, some more violent action sometimes, and then a Citizen Assembly, which is more the institutional part and like the concrete structure of the debate for climate change. And I think that's an important thing to say also, like if you're organizing a Citizen Assembly as a country, and here in France, like the main political sponsor was President Macron, and at the end of the day, there was 150 citizens working for doing his job, because he's the one supposed to do a political law on climate change. And what we see is that it was the best way, the Citizen Assembly, to actually avoid going to the political turmoil that exists in France and never get things done. But at the end of the day, there's nothing done also. So, and there's half measures and stuff like that. So Citizen Assembly cannot be alone, the response to climate, like to discussions on climate change. And I think, as you said, we need to complement it with, you know, some other types of actions also.
But I think that applies not only to climate change, but exactly. to citizen assemblies in general.
Agree.
When they're in isolation, it might not get the effect that when you add on other types of participatory processes, which allows also open society and get a greater impact.
Okay. Yeah, I think that one of the great effects, I think, in France has been to translate the, let's say, the debate from the citizen assembly to a general public that that maybe were not so aware before that. Of course, in NGOs and a lot of people was already very conscious of it, but it has really, I think, you know, opened up a debate in the world society, and now any measure related to climate or to ecology are compared to what the Citizen Convention said, and I think that's a big step also in the public discussion.
I have one question maybe for all of us, that something that we haven't really figured out, but it's the question of trust or empathy in the online relationships. And we were talking about it before we started the streaming, but I think we've been in months doing this online working, online social moments, birthdays, everything. And I think we all agree that it's not the same. And I don't know, the physical interaction, the empathy that we get when we're in the same room and we get the break conversation that you ask about their family and stuff, how to replicate this in an online context, and can it be, first maybe, can it be replicated, and if so, how? And I was just thinking, that's maybe a question for the community or for you, if you have some knowledge about it, but looking maybe at the gaming community, because there's this huge online community that has been developing for some years now, and that they don't know each other and they still collaborate, maybe for another purpose, but they still collaborate and there's still some trust. So I don't know, it's a question that still goes in my mind.
Yeah, I think it's an important question. I don't know, maybe we should create some, you know, after work sessions in the Citizen Assembly process so we can have informal moments. Because I think it's never going to be the same thing as an in-person, in-person moment where you actually have those moments of just like non-pressure to discuss about the subject in hand. And what I see from collaborations that started this year only digitally, the moments that were key for feeling the human behind the collaboration was, informal discussions online. Some moments where we like would text also each other. It's not the same, you know, it's different ways of communicating than, you know, that moment on Zoom or that moment on Jitsi. But it's a good question for like citizen assembly online, because that's going to be quite complicated to actually do.
Yeah, yes, sure. Well, Kelly, I think you're already testing some in many places, like these coffee breaks or whatever that are also happening online.
So yeah, we've kind of got, you can build them into the process, and we have open lunch space, and we have small groups that meet outside online. But there's something about the actual conversation. So you're all listening to me just holding the space now. And there's something more transactional that happens online because you can't all kind of chatter at the same time in a way. It doesn't work. And you go quiet and you're waiting for someone to say, okay, over to you, Kelly, now. It just doesn't have that same level of relationship. And I don't know whether that has an impact or not, but it just feels different, doesn't it?
It does. And, one of the processes we're doing in Scotland, it started in person and then it moved online. When we're in person, of course, people shared meals together and you can do it online. It doesn't feel the same, let's be honest, but you can do it. You can send snack packs out to people if you like, which has been done at the local level, though. It's quite a difficult thing to do, it turns out. But, you know, things happened in that space together, like an informal music group formed who would play in the evenings and things like that. You have to forcefully create that space online, as it were. You have to say, be here at this time to do it. So you do miss some of that kind of more spontaneous kind of building of social relationships that you may get in that offline space. It does feel a bit more kind of planned and intentional. Planned fun.
I will just say, though, I think the trust and empathy still happens.
I agree.
Actually, you see participants taking responsibility for each other and helping each other with the tools and checking sure everyone can participate. And, you know, for example, one of the local assemblies we've got, because of COVID, homeless person was put into temporary accommodation, therefore got an invitation, therefore is part of a citizens assembly who would never have been included, who's got, mm-hmm. you know, so everyone's kind of celebratory, more inclusive, thinking about access for each other. So in that sense, digital's not made a problem at all, and in fact probably enhanced that taking responsibility.
Yeah, exactly. I think that in some sense it's more egalitarian because you don't need also these social skills that maybe some of us don't have in the physical space, and you really have the same interaction, you know, between all the people, and there is no biases there. Mm.
And it's also why, sorry, I'm just going to add a small point. It's also why there's like those moments of, like, as you said, Mauricio, I think in your presentation, like asynchronous and synchronous moments, like, you have, that's what we imagined also in all of our process, and I'm sure you too, like you create some moments online like we do right now, but we also think about a continuous democratic process on Decidim, on the platform, where basically you offer to the citizen different types of interaction, and if they're not comfortable with speaking in front of you right now, then they're going to be more comfortable maybe writing, you know, calmly in their house, the contribution on the platform. So I think what's also key here is to offer the citizen multiple ways of participating, and some more comfortable yeah. ones, some less comfortable one, etc.
Great. So we have to close the conversation. It was really, really nice talking to you. We can continue the debate and the conversation in the CDM. You know that there are several forums that are open. We will do now a small pause, a 20-minute pause, and we'll start again at 12 with a debate called Research Driven Art with Caroline Sinders and Tyrone Diaz. So see you later, and thank you again.
Thank you very much.
Thanks, everyone. Bye.